Hi friends, welcome to calendar year Hepgec program for daily revision. Here we are going to discuss both UPSC previous year and model questions. So let's move on to question number 1, which is on ancient history. Which of the following characterizes or characterize the people of Indus civilization? Statement number 1, they possess great palaces and temples. Statement 2, they worship both male and female deities. Statement 3, they employed horse-drawn chariots in warfare. So one thing we have to note here is that Indus civilization or Indus Valley civilization is one of the most important topic in ancient history. Many questions were asked from this chapter. So during our preparation time, we must not leave this chapter at any cost. So moving on to statement number 1, they possess great palaces and temples. When we started learning IVC, we came to know that they were very excellent in their burnt brick constructions. And they are good at their drainage systems and multi-storied buildings. But so far, we couldn't get any evidence of great palaces and temples. Because mostly because with urbanized nature, IVC people most probably were ruled by the merchant classes and not by aristocrats. So we can say that no palaces were built at that time. Also, because of the secular nature and the worship towards nature, they didn't construct any kind of temples. So we can easily say that statement 1 is wrong. And just because statement 1 is wrong, we can eliminate option A and option C. When moving on to statement number 2, it says that they worship both male and female deities. Yes, because we know that they worship mother goddesses, proto-Shiva, and also they worship male and female sex organs which are made up of stone. So very easily, it is clear that they worship both male and female deities. So statement 2 is right. When moving on to statement 3, it says that they employed horse-drawn chariots in the warfare. Since they are peace-loving people, they are not engaged in any kind of war. So employ horse is also a wrong statement. So statement 3 is also wrong in this case. So the correct answer is option B, only 2. Moving on to next question on economy regarding Monetary Policy Committee. Which of the following statements are correct regarding the Monetary Policy Committee? Statement 1, it decides the RBI's benchmark interest rates. Statement 2, it is a 12-member body including the RBI governor and is reconstituted every year. Statement 3, it functions under the chairmanship of Union Finance Minister. When we know about RBI, the core functions of RBI is to fix its benchmark rate called repo rate and to contain inflation. The duty of RBI is to contain inflation of about 4% with a margin of plus or minus 2. That means the inflation of our country should be between 2% to 6%. And the duty of fixing repo rate is entrusted to Monetary Policy Committee. That is statement number 1. It decides the RBI's benchmark interest rate, that is repo rate, which is used in banking operations. So statement 1 is right. So just because of statement 1 is right, the answer should be either A or B. So we can rule out option C and option D. That means option 3 is wrong, which says that it is under the chairmanship of Union Finance Minister, but actually it is under the chairmanship of RBI Governor. So when moving on to statement number 2, it says that it is a 12-member body. It is wrong because Monetary Policy Committee consists of 6 members, from which 3 are from RBI and 3 are appointed by the central government. So statement 2 is also wrong. By this we arrive at the answer. Option A is the correct answer. Let's move on to question number 3, which is from polity. Consider the following statements. Statement number 1, the Constitution of India has 20 parts. Statement 2, there are 390 articles in the Constitution of India in all. Statement 3, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th schedules were added to the Constitution of India by the Constitutional Amendment Acts. So as we know, Constitution is just simply a law book which says that how India should be governed. And it is divided into various parts, schedules and articles. When the Constitution was formed and enacted in the 1950s, It consists of 22 parts and 8 schedules and 395 articles. And later on, due to further amendment in the sense, the power of parliament to make changes in the constitution. This is called amendment. So, because of the power of parliament to make changes in our constitution due to changing needs, many amendment acts were enacted. And because of that, the size of our constitution get enlarged. Now, it contains 25 parts, 12 schedules, and more than 450 articles. So, based on this fact, we can eliminate statement number 1 and statement number 2, which says that about 20 parts, and statement 2 says there are only 390 articles. So, 1 and 2 are wrong. So, A can be eliminated, B can be eliminated, also D can also be eliminated. So, without going to the third statement itself, we came to the answer, option C. By doing so, we can gain few seconds, which is very crucial during the prelims test, so that we can attain more number of questions. Even though, as of now, for a revision purpose, let's move on to the third statement also. The 9, 10th, 11th and 12th schedules were added to the Constitution of India by amendments. That's very true. So, the answer is option C, 3 only. Let's move on to the next question, which is about geography, regarding Indian Ocean Dipole. With reference to Indian Ocean Dipole while forecasting Indian monsoon, which of the following statements is or correct? Statement number 1, IOD phenomenon is characterized by a difference in sea surface temperature between tropical western Indian Ocean and tropical eastern Pacific Ocean. So, IOD, that is Indian Ocean Dipole, means an oscillating sea surface temperature. That means the Indian Ocean part become alternate, sea surface become alternately warmer and cooler. So, it can be divided into two types. One is positive IOD and negative IOD. Positive IOD in the sense, the western Indian Ocean sea surface temperature increases than the normal. And negative IOD in the sense, the sea surface temperature of western Indian Ocean becomes lesser than the normal. So, in these cases, positive IOD, that means increase in sea surface temperature in the western part of Indian Ocean, which increases the evaporation rate, so that we could gain some more amount of rainfall in the Indian subcontinent. And if it is negative IOD, that means temperature is less than the normal, we couldn't get much rain during that phenomenon. Okay? So, when moving on to statement number 1, it says that it is a difference in sea surface temperature between tropical western Indian Ocean and tropical eastern Pacific Ocean. Actually, it is eastern Indian Ocean. So, the statement 1 is wrong. When moving on to IOD statement number 2, which says that IOD phenomenon can influence the El Niño's impact on monsoon. Yeah. During El Niño years, we face drought in the Indian subcontinent. At that time, if we are experiencing positive IOD, which could bring some amount of rainfall to the Indian subcontinent. So, we can say that there is a small amount of influence of IOD during El Niño's impact in the monsoon. So, we can easily say that statement 2 is the only right answer. So, answer is B, 2 only. Moving on to next question on environment regarding an institution called Bombay Natural History Society. Consider the following statements. Statement number 1. It is an autonomous organization under the Ministry of Environment and Forest. Statement 2. It strives to conserve nature through action-based research, education and public awareness. Statement 3. It organizes and conducts nature trials and camps for general public. So, Bombay Natural History Society, it is an NGO actually and not comes under any ministries, and its aim is to promote natural conservation. Here it says that it is under the Ministry of Environment and Forest. Actually, it is an NGO. So, statement 1 can be ruled out. Just because statement 1 is wrong, we can eliminate option A and option B. Sorry, option A and option D. So from this, one thing is crystal clear that statement 2 should be right. So we can skip to statement number 3. As I told you earlier, by these things, by these type of techniques, we could gain few seconds, which are very crucial during our prelims examinations. So statement 2 is already right. Moving on to statement 3. It organizes and conducts natural trials and camps for the general public. Yes, that's true, because it conducts similar programs. So the answer here is option C. That's all for today. Thank you.